We'll call to order this meeting of the Assembly Higher Education Committee. We will convene as a subcommittee. We don't have a quorum yet. As soon as we have a quorum, Secretary will call the roll and establish such. At this point, I'd like to announce for those in the audience who are interested, we do have two bills that have been pulled from today's agenda. They'll be heard in the future. So if you're here particularly for one of these two bills, we're not going to hear it today. First bill is AB 515 by Assemblywoman Brownlee. That will be heard in the future. And second bill, Assembly Bill 948 by Mr. Ferrattani, also pulled from today's agenda, will be heard in the future. We also have five consent items today. We'll be voting on them once we have a quorum. AB 334 Lowenthal, AB 478 Hernandez, AB 743 Block, AB 853 Blumenfield, and AB 1013, which is a committee bill, Committee on Higher Education. We are going in sign-in order today. We will hear bills even though we do not yet have a quorum. And I see that Assemblywoman Harkey is here with us. So, Assemblywoman Harkey, do you want to come forward? Do we have a list of who's signed in? On this bill, as in all others we'll hear today, we will have opening statement by the author, up to 6 minutes total of witness statements for, then witnesses against. Then we'll have questions or comments by members of the committee. The author will have an opportunity to close, and then the committee members will ask further questions or move to a vote. At this point, I will welcome Ms. Harkey.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair and members. California is honored to have produced many young men and women who have joined the armed forces to protect our country and the values that we hold dear. In California, there are over 2.2 million veterans and 35,000 receiving GI Bill benefits at California community colleges. One of the most important ways in which we can express our gratitude to these individuals is take necessary steps in making their transition from military to civilian life a successful one. Obtaining a college degree is important to many veterans as they return home to begin to plan for their future. Currently, some veterans have faced a difficulty in receiving federal funds for their education. In order to receive benefits of a GI Bill, veterans must follow strict guidelines and taking specific set of courses in a particular time frame, which has now become an obstacle in California because of impacted classes and student competition. AB 649 will clarify that veterans receive priority for classes in our community college and state universities. By providing this priority, veterans will not only have a smoother transition, but will also have the ability to meet requirements of the GI Bill so that they can take full advantage of the federal funds they have earned. In addition, AB 649 will extend the period that a veteran could receive these privileges from 2 to 5 years. And allow me to correct myself. I believe the priority and registering for classes, has that been amended out?
It's the admissions that have, but the class registration.
Okay, the registration, but the admissions is still
admissions is out, as I understand it. Yes.
Right. In addition, AB 649 will extend the period that a veteran could require or could receive these privileges from 2 to 5 years. Many veterans require more than 2 years to finish the classes, many of them from trauma and trying to decompress. And so we feel that this is warranted, and like we said, a lot of them is because of the impacted classes. This bill is an important step for California in showing our appreciation to our veterans and providing the necessary tools to prepare themselves for a successful post-military career by assisting them in attaining a degree, which is vital to be competitive in the 21st century job environment. AB 649 has received bipartisan co-authorship, and I look forward to working with anyone interested in assisting our student veterans as they pursue their education goals. I'm willing to accept committee suggestions for amendments and would respectfully request your aye vote.
Thank you, Ms. Harkey. Your witnesses?
Yes, Anthony Belote. He's a student veteran, California. Student veterans, California. Is Anthony speaking?
Yes, that's me. I'm a Marine veteran, and I've been attending school for the past several years and working at Saddleback College Vet Center. And I'm seeing The results of a prolonged war that has affected veterans, both from mental and physical aspects, and the 2 years that's currently on the books is really just not enough time. They're coming home, and they need time to decompress and reassess their lives, and 2 years is simply just not enough time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Brent Theobald, Graham Vanguard. Brent, are you speaking?
David Curry.
No.
David Curry. Yes.
Well, sorry, I amend my notes.
Okay. Okay. Good afternoon, Higher Education Committee members. My name is David Curry. I am a Iraq War veteran of the United States Marine Corps, served two tours in Iraq. I had experience to actually launch two veterans programs at a community college in UC Irvine, respectively. And one of the things I noticed on the ground in terms of starting this initiative that basically started out of a storage closet was many of the transitional issues that were a lot of my peers that were coming back home and a lot of my junior Marines and service members who were having issues with things such as unemployment, suicide, drug addiction, substance abuse, even issues of domestic violence that weren't being addressed because of the inadequate transition process from active duty to military, from active duty to civilian life. Particularly the two points of entry when a service member exits active duty is generally your unemployment offices, your EDD-1 stops, or your higher education institutions such as your community colleges, your CSUs, as well as your UCs. Typically 95% of your veterans population goes through your community colleges first. Now the two-year time frame, typically most veterans, one, have a very untraditional academic type of course because of the fact that they start classes based on when they get discharged from the military. So therefore, they might start classes based on when their discharge date is in January. They might start it in September. And that's totally outside of their control. Two, because of the fact that a lot of these veteran students are, one, first-generation college students, and they've been out of school as reentry students for about 5 years, they have to place a lot of emphasis on remedial courses. Therefore, they spend about 2.5 up to 3 years at your community colleges. So by the time they get to your UC and Cal State institutions, that two-year timeline of Senate Bill 272 and 361 has already expired. So therefore, when you get to these four-year institutions, and based on the certification process of VA benefits, which is a federal benefit that's been ultimately extended to veterans, and essentially by approving this measure is basically being able to honor our commitment to veterans that the federal government has made, ultimately we allow them to be able to utilize this benefit at the CSUs and the UCs. Moreover, because of the fact that they need to be able to satisfy the number of courses they take, unlike traditional financial aid that's simply workload credit, they have to maintain academic credit in order to certify their benefits to get things such as full tuition paid for or BAH, which is a basic allowance for housing. A little short fact, in the year 2009, just in the community college system alone, the CSU system, in terms of the returns to the economy of veterans' basic allowance for housing, brought $63 million a month back into our economy, with a base rate of about an average of $1,800 a month in BAH over 35,000 community college.
Okay, let me interrupt you for a second here. We do have a quorum that has now arrived. We're going to take a vote. After we vote, your witnesses will have a total of 2 minutes left. Will the secretary please call the roll for a quorum?
Block.
Here.
Donnelly.
Here.
Asajian,
here.
Brownlee, Fong, Galgiani, Lara,
here.
Miller, Portantino.
Here.
Okay, we have a quorum.
Thank you. We have a quorum. I'm sorry to interrupt you like that, but we just need to make sure we get a vote taken when everybody's here. At this point, your witnesses in total have 2 minutes left. You may continue.
So ultimately speaking on behalf of one of the 2.2 million veterans in the state of California and one of the 40,000 student or 2.2 veterans and one of the 40,000 student veterans of the state of California, ultimately we see this as a stepping stone in terms of the honoring the commitment to veterans to be able to ensure a successful transition to civilian life via using education as a pathway to obtain gainful employment and ultimately achieve that capstone of veterans' benefits, just as home ownership that benefits not only the veteran but the California economy as a whole. Thank you.
Lorraine Plass, Legislative Chair for American Veterans of the State of California and co-author of this bill. We support this bill.
Mr. Chairman, Pete Conaty representing several veterans groups, and we're in support of this bill. The American Legion, the California Association of County Veterans Service Officers, California State Commanders Veterans Council, the California Chapter of the Military Officers Association of America, and the Vietnam Veterans of America. And Mr. Chairman, if you could indulge us, we have about 6-8 veteran students here, and I wonder if they could just come up and identify themselves for the committee.
Sure. Are they going to support the bill?
Yes, sir.
But we'll ask them each to come up along with any other supporters, identify themselves, if they represent an organization, tell us whom, and just state that they are in support. So at this point, I will ask all those who support the bill, please come forward, state your name, organization, and your support.
Mr. Chair, I move the bill.
Second.
Okay, bill's been moved by Mr. Ashajian, seconded by Mr. Portantino. Go ahead.
Jack Williams, student veteran of California, Marine veteran. I'm in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Brent Theobald, student veterans of California, also vice president of a Veterans Consortium, representing 19 colleges and universities. And we are also unanimously supportive of the bill.
Thank you.
Hello, Amy Yatt, veterans coordinator, Solano Community College, and I'm in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Eric Dunn, Marine vet, in support of it.
Thank you.
Jennifer Munn, U.S. Army veteran. I'm in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Nadia Leal Carrillo with the University of California in support, and thank you to the author for addressing our concerns.
Thank you.
Ben Strickland, U.S. Navy veteran, Monterey Peninsula College student, in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Andrew Martinez, California State University. We did have an opposed position, but we want to thank the author for taking the amendment. It addresses our concern. Thank you.
So are you now in support or neutral or?
I don't have a position yet on the bill, but
okay,
we are
so no position. Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Any witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, any questions or comments from members of the committee? Mr. Portantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Ms. Harkey, for working with the committee on getting the bill to where it is, and to all the veterans who came out. I've said to some of you in the past that my father went to college on the GI Bill of Rights, first in my family, until my older brother to go to college. And so I'd like to be at it as a co-author, if you wouldn't mind, and proud to support it.
Thank you. Pleased to do so.
Okay. Mr. Sajjan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I'll be happy to be co-author on this bill as well. Just want to take a moment and thank all the veterans for your services. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sajjan. Any other? Mr. Donnelly.
Thank you, Ms. Harkey. And to the veterans, I would also like to be a co-author on your bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions? Okay, at this point then, Ms. Harkey, you may close.
I thank you so much for your time and committee members, and I also thank the support that I got throughout the community and from everyone involved. We've had a great program going at Saddleback, which is a local community college in southern Orange County. And I would like to see more of these programs expanded. And as you allow this, I think we'll see that. So thank you so very much. And thank you to everyone who spoke and for their service.
Thank you, Ms. Harkey. The bill has been moved by Mr. Portantino, seconded by Mr. Ashajian. The motion before us is do pass as amended to the Appropriations Committee. Chair recommends an aye vote. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Block.
Aye.
Block aye. Donnelly?
Aye.
Donnelly, aye. Ashajian?
Aye.
Ashajian, aye. Brownlee? Fong? Galgiani? Galgiani, aye. Lara?
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller? Portantino?
Aye.
Portantino, aye.
6-0.
That's 6-0, so your bill is out. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes, we do. Okay, Mr. Gordon, please come forward and have a seat. Welcome to the Higher Education Committee. Your bill, AB 611, is item number 7 on today's agenda. Mr. Gordon, you may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. AB 611 improves disclosure rules at for-profit post-secondary institutions, those institutions that are under the purview of the Bureau for Private Post-Secondary Education. This requires these schools with unaccredited doctoral programs to disclose the accreditation status and related limitations on the degree prior to enrolling students in these often lengthy and expensive programs. Recent reports on the state and national level have demonstrated a need for greater transparency in the methods private for-profit post-secondary institutions use to recruit and enroll students. These private for-profit schools have seen a 236% jump in enrollment over a 10-year period. This compares to a 20% jump in enrollment for private, nonprofit, and post-secondary public institutions. The language in AB 611 derives from a previous bill. It was a collaborative effort between the for-profit post-secondary schools and consumer interests in order to ensure that students enrolling in these programs are aware of the constraints in obtaining an unaccredited doctoral degree. This law will have the greatest impact on schools offering unaccredited doctoral programs in subjects like philosophy, theology, hypnotherapy, business administration, among others. In 2000, a similar consumer protection was added to code sections in B&P to assist students pursuing unaccredited doctoral degrees in psychology. This bill has no formal opposition, I would urge an aye vote for the purposes of providing greater transparency to prospective students.
Thank you, Mr. Gordon. Do you have any witnesses in support who wish to speak to us?
No witnesses.
Are there any witnesses in support in the back? Seeing none, any witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, any... The bill has been moved by Mr. Sajjan, seconded by Ms. Galjani. Any questions or comments from committee members? Mr. Lara.
Mr. Gordon, thank you so much for bringing this important measure. I support AB 611 and enacts useful provisions with respect to Private Post-Secondary Education Act. This bill is not the first item we will see that addresses this, that addresses the act. Fixes I think such as these are going to be needed, and I think we need to look all around at how we can further protect our student consumers and ensure that they get the best value for their money. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Mr. Gard, do you wish to close?
I would just simply urge an aye vote.
Thank you. At this point, the motion is due pass to the Assembly Business and Professions Committee. Chair recommends an aye vote. Secretary, please call the roll.
Block.
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly.
Aye.
Donnelly, aye. Asajjan.
Aye.
Asajjan, aye. Brownlee. Fong. Galgiani.
Aye.
Galgiani, aye. Lara. Lara, aye. Miller, Portantino.
That's 5-0. That's 5 votes. Your bill is out. Thank you, Mr. Gordon.
Thank you very much.
At this point, the chair would like to take up the consent calendar. On the consent calendar, there are 5 bills. First is AB 334 by Lowenthal. Second, AB 478 by Hernandez. Third, AB 743 by Block. Fourth, AB 853 by Blumenfeld. And fifth, AB 1013, it's a committee bill, Committee on Higher Education. Is there a motion to adopt the consent calendar?
Move the bills under consent.
Moved by Mr. Sajjan, seconded by Ms. Galgiani. Okay, at this point, I'll ask the secretary to call the roll.
Block.
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly.
Aye.
Donnelly, aye. Asajjan.
Aye.
Asajjan, aye. Brownlee. Fong. Galgiani. Galgiani, aye. Lara.
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller, Portantino.
It's 5-0. And the consent calendar is 5-0. We now move, well, we have no authors. We could go to committee authors. Are there any committee authors? Not sure. Actually, Mr. Lara, before, generally, if it's committee bills, it's committee members first, then the vice chair, then the chair. So, Mr. Lara, you would be next if you're ready. Okay. Thank you, sir. This is AB 176. Mr. Lara.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. AB 176 will ensure that all students are treated equally when seeking admission to a post-secondary standardized exam like the GRE, MCAT, LSAT, and GMAT by requiring test sponsors to provide a process for verifying a test subject's identity when the test subject is unable to provide the required identification, such as a government-issued license or ID card. First off, I would like to state that we are agreeing to the Assembly Higher Education Committee's amendments located on page 2 of your latest committee analysis. And the current law establishes various requirements and procedures for test sponsors to follow in administering standardized tests for admission to or placement in post-secondary educational institutions and programs. However, test sponsors lack a uniform process to provide students with the alternative forms for identification when they are unable to meet the required forms of ID. As you recall, AB 540, under current law, students applying for public colleges or universities who have an undocumented status are eligible to receive in-state tuition if they graduated from a California high school and meet other requirements under California Education Code 68130.5. However, because many test sponsors require government-issued identification, which many of these students cannot produce, students who do not possess the required ID methods, including AB 540 students, may be at a disadvantage or precluded from taking post-secondary education standardized exams like I mentioned before, the GRE, GMAT, LSAT, or MCAT. AB 176 will solve this problem by requiring test sponsors to establish an alternative ID verification for those students unable to obtain otherwise required ID. Specifically, AB 976 will allow students to contact test sponsors prior to the exam in order to identify a process for verification, And AB 176 will also provide test sponsors with the flexibility in the process for verifying a student's identification and the types of acceptable forms of ID. This way, a student's lack of government-issued ID will not preclude them and the ability from taking the exams aforementioned.
Moved by Member Galjani, seconded by Mr. Asajian. Mr. Lara, your witnesses have up to 6 minutes total.
Good afternoon, Chair members. My name is Olga Nilia Ramirez. I'm with the California State Student Association, which serves as the official voice for the 433,000 California State University students. Assembly Member Lara outlined the problem. I just wanted to give you an example. This morning, I heard two separate stories from students who attempted to take one of these exams using the IDs that they had on them. They were turned away, and as a result, they had to forfeit their test fees, which can be from $150 to $250. And given that these students are AB 54 students, very difficult for them to come up with those funds again to pay for those exams. Also, as you know, the bill requires test sponsors to work with undocumented students who fit the AB 540 criteria to find viable alternatives for identifying themselves. We believe this will secure a clear path for these students to achieve their educational goals. We believe this bill would remove any unnecessary barriers on motivated and intelligent students who seek post-secondary education. We respectfully ask for your support on this measure. Thanks.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Erica Romero with the Hispanic Association of Colleges and Universities. Some of our AB 540 students are the best and brightest and most motivated students, and the ID stands as a barrier to their education, and we know that it's a long and arduous process to become a U.S. citizen, and many of those students will be going through the process. In the meantime, they can be securing a higher education, and we would urge the committee to pass the bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support, please come forward, state your name, the organization you represent, and that you are in support.
Antoinette Camo with the University of California Student Association in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Joseph Vigela on behalf of the Coalition for Humane Immigrant Rights of Los Angeles in support.
Thank you.
Hi,
Leslie Medina with Capital Advocacy. I represent the Association of American Medical Colleges that administer the MCATs, the medical exam, and the Law School Admissions Council that administers the LSATs. We did have an opposed position, but we have removed that and are now neutral with the committee's amendments, and want to thank the author and the committee staff for all their work they've done on this.
Okay, thank you. Others in support?
Lisbeth Maldonado on behalf of Stand at Sac State in strong support.
Thank you.
Anna Ruth Hernandez on behalf of the ANSA Associated Student Body in strong support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Daniel Galan on behalf of the ANSA Community College in strong support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oralieras on behalf of IMAS from the ANSA College in
thank
support.
You.
Alex Pater, President, Student Senate for California Community Colleges, representing 2.7 million students across 112 campuses, and we're in support. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition, please come forward. Seeing none, Mr. Sajjan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to thank Mr. Lara for the amendments. I was another question concerning the IDs. The students that were sent away and forfeited their fees, did they have other IDs that would have qualified them, and why were these IDs not acceptable? Could it be improved by picture, signature?
Well, you know, that's the problem, Mr. Ashajian, is that there's no uniformed method in terms of addressing not only AB 540 students, but there's students that are currently have exile status or so other you know, immigration-related issues that preclude them from having an ID. And some of the schools, the issues that some of the schools think that there's security reasons with their current university ID, which is addressing a whole other issue of the security aspect of when students are issued an ID and showing that those are the actual students. So, you know, that's what one of the issues we're trying to solve here is ensuring that we create a uniform process. So there's not a piecemeal kind of approach.
My understanding, university IDs do have pictures, don't they?
They do, but there's some of the issues that we're running across in terms of discussing this bill, is that a lot of the private test taking companies usually ask for a secondary ID, and so that is also an issue, and so there's concerns of you know, safety issues in terms of is this the actual person or any fraud related stuff.
I think that will question go away. I wasn't aware of the secondary ID. As long as we have a picture that matches the person, and I remember when I was a foreign student, and my ID did have my picture on it, signature, so it made it much easier to answer some questions. So I'm hoping that this will be part of what we're trying to promote and make life easier for everybody concerned.
Right, that's what we're trying to do. Thank you, Mr. Sandra.
Mr. Donnelly.
Thank you, Mr. Lara. I have a question related to identification. I understand that the perpetrators of 9/11 took a flight test, and so they had to produce certain types of ID. Now, what types of ID in your case would be acceptable versus what they were able to use? Because I'm worried that we're weakening something that is a protection in certain areas. I understand the problem you're trying to solve, but I'm just concerned about national security here.
I appreciate your concern, as am I. This bill is suggesting that we create a uniform process, and I'm going to leave that to the test sponsors to work out a process that is fair and that takes into concern your issues as well.
Thank you.
Any further questions or comments from members of the committee? Seeing none, Mr. Lara, you may close.
I respectfully ask for I vote.
Thank you, Mr. Lara. At this point, we have a motion from Ms. Galgiani, a second from Mr. Asajian. The chair is recommending an I vote do pass as amended to the assembly floor. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Block.
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly.
No.
Donnelly, no. Asajian.
Aye.
Asajian, aye. Brownlee.
Aye.
Brownlee, aye. Fong. Galgiani.
Aye.
Galgiani, aye. Lara.
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller. Portantino.
5-1, your bill is out. Thank you, Mr. Lara.
Thank you.
Okay, our next author is Assemblywoman Mitchell on AB 835. Ms. Mitchell, please come forward. It is item number 11 in your agenda, members.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. I'm glad to be here today to present Assembly Bill 835, a measure which calls for better coordination between career technical education programs, high schools, and community colleges in order to maximize student participation. In 2005, Senator Scott introduced SB 70, which required community colleges to assist economic and workforce regional development centers to improve career technical education pathways between high schools and community colleges. Since the passage of SB 70, workshops have been developed that provide students from diverse geographic regions with in-depth career exploration, as well as marketable skills that will assist them in developing a career upon graduation. In implementing this type of strategy, sponsors have encountered administrative barriers at both the school district level and community college level. These policies have prevented some economically disadvantaged students from having equal access to the educational opportunities that peers from more affluent communities might enjoy. Studies have shown that students who complete such courses are significantly more likely to pursue higher education and to have higher paying careers. AB 835 removes many of the admin barriers that have been identified by the participating programs in order to maximize participation.
Second. Moved by Mr. Lara, seconded by Ms. Galgiani. You may continue.
Thank you very much. Lastly, I'd just like to thank the committee for working with us to draft some amendment language. We're going to continue to address the bills, the committee's concerns, and we'll be accepting those amendments today. And I've got a witness here in support, Mr. Epstein from the Environmental Academy Boosters, the bill sponsors.
Thank you very much. My name is Mark Epstein. I am project manager of NorCal Environmental Student Network, and as part of that role, I also serve as statewide coordinator for what is known as the SB 70 Environmental Career Preparation Program, which has been developed in partnership with the community colleges' environmental training centers. AB 835 was drafted from the experience of our program and the frustrations of the high school career academy and pathway programs. We all realize that the Great Recession has hurt all governmental services. As a result, we accept that the secondary academy programs will take their share of pain due to the reduction of funds. However, lacking the ability to utilize non-state taxpayer funding to deliver services due to administrative policies is frustrating for teachers, students, and the sponsors. The intent of this bill is to clarify little-used authority in a new way to make it possible to meet the needs of students in the high school academy and pathway programs to gain specific foundational employability skills and community college credit without the use of state tax dollars. The discussion of how to reform and use taxpayer funds in career technical education can wait for a future day. What we are asking is to have the tools to deliver educational opportunities to the economically disadvantaged students of the academy and pathway programs using non-state dollars we can attain without the restriction of outdated policies and procedures. We ask an aye vote on AB 835.
Thank you.
Terry Burns on behalf of the California Association of Leaders of Career Preparation, CALSIP. We're the folks who do career technical education at the K-8 levels. We're very supportive of these kind of programs that cross systems and work effectively for students. We will be asking the author to clarify in the bill that this won't apply to coursework that is duplicative of coursework that is available at the high school level. Mm-hmm. And we anticipate that's fully the intent. But these programs, that is a very rare instance. For the most part, these are so well coordinated that you really are looking at the next step. So we're very supportive of the measure.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, any questions or comments from committee members? Okay, Ms. Mitchell, you may close.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I ask for your aye vote.
All right, thank you. We do have a motion by Mr. Lara, a second by Ms. Galgiani. Ms. Mitchell, thank you for this bill, and thank you for accepting the amendments. And just keep us informed, if you would, as this bill proceeds through the process of any other changes. At this point, the chair recommends an aye vote. Do pass to the Assembly Education. Ms. Brownlee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I didn't want to interrupt you, but I just wanted to say that I'm very supportive of this bill, but it is double referred to my committee, so I'm going to hold off on my vote until the bill comes there. But I'm very supportive of it.
Thank you for clarifying that, Ms. Brownlee. And it is due pass to the Assembly Education Committee, so you will be seeing it again. I would ask the Secretary to call the roll.
Block.
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly.
Aye.
Donnelly, aye. Asajian.
Aye.
Asajian, aye. Brownlee. Fong. Galgiani.
Aye.
Galgiani, aye. Lara.
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller. Portantino.
5-0. Okay, 5-0. Your bill is out. Thank you, Ms. Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thanks, committee member.
Next, we have Mr. Gatto. Item number 4, it's AB 404. Please come forward.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, members. Today it's a great honor for me to present AB 404, which calls for the establishment of a Native American Language Institute that will be housed at the state university system. I'm not sure how many members of this board or of this committee realize that California has the most Native American diversity of any state in the nation. We have 109 federally recognized American Indian tribes here. That's the largest number of tribal nations in the United States. Before the contact with the New World, there are 80 distinct indigenous languages here, and most of those languages are in real danger of becoming extinct. They have very, very small numbers of people who speak them as a native tongue. We had a situation in this country for many years where speaking a second language was considered something that just wasn't done. It was to be discouraged. And if you all, on this committee, in some cases it'll be your parents or your grandparents, you talk with them about their experience speaking whatever language that they spoke. Chances are that people, there's great pressure in this country to not speak it. Now, the same thing has been happening with Native American languages, but that's been happening for 500 years. And because of that, you have a lot of tribes here that have one or two native speakers left. And those speakers are very old. And in many cases, there is not the resources or the know-how present in these tribes to transmit the language and transmit the culture to current generations. And every time that we lose a language, members, we lose a tremendous amount of culture. We lose words for native plants, native species, native animals. We lose the very fabric that keeps a culture going. So the idea with this bill is to create a program whereby the state of California would go out and first focus on the tribes that really need it, the tribes without existing language preservation programs, and provide these tribes the resources to record and to preserve their languages. This means, in some cases, tape recording devices, in some cases, the know-how to create a dictionary and to preserve that for future generations. And then to house this institute at a Cal State or UC campus, providing additional money for the Cal State or UC system, not taking away from their existing budget, but providing additional money for the school that houses it, where we'll have a repository of language know-how for people to come study. So I can also say that this is modeled after a couple other programs in other states. Texas and Utah have programs to this effect. Utah is for Native American languages as well. In Texas, it's to study German dialects that are at risk of being lost in German. But those states both have very, very wonderful programs. And what they do is they preserve the linguistic heritage in those states. I think my staff was kind enough to pass around in your packages some of the articles that talk about the dangers that we face in this state of losing our heritage. Because even though this is the heritage of the tribe that faces the language extinction, it's also our heritage, members. I mean, we have... You know, a state here, I come from a part of the state that typically gets rid of its history. Southern California is not that well known or not that well regarded in terms of preserving our history. And but this is California history. This is the very, Mr. Lara disagrees, but this is our heritage. This is the state's heritage, and it's what makes us who we are. So I guess right now I'd like to I'll turn it over to some of the witnesses who have come here to testify.
And okay, Mr. Hatter, your witnesses have 6 minutes in total.
Thank you.
I'll be a lot shorter than that. David Quintana today on behalf of the California Tribal Business Alliance, the Piscenta Band of Noblaki Indians, the Pala Band of Mission Indians, the Viejas Band of Kumeyaay Indians, and the Picayune Rancheria, the Chukchansi Indians, were all in strong support of this bill. 0% of your analysis was spent on the almost complete destruction of Native American languages in California due to state and federal policy. So let me just give you two illustrations, if I may. At Viejas, there are approximately 250 members to the Viejas band. There are four speakers left, all of them over the age of 60. At Chukchansi in the Central Valley, there are 1,500 members of the tribe, and there are approximately 10 speakers out of 1,500 members left. So since your analysis didn't address that, I wanted to give you two illustrations.
Thank you.
My name is Zoe Devine, and I'm the director of the Center for Indian Community Development. The center has been around for about 47 years and actually began as an assembly bill. It was a piece of legislation, and its entire mandate is Native American languages because that interest and that need is so strong and has been and so important within California. Mm-hmm. And I'm just here to speak on behalf of the tribes and say that this... Yeah. Legislation is extremely important to their cultural and political futures as well, and to us as a state in terms of our identity and histories.
Thank you.
My name is Chag Lowry. I am of Yurok, Pitt River, and Maidu ancestry. Those are all California Native tribes in Northern California. I am the program officer for the Native Cultures Fund, which serves almost the entire state of California. In support of California indigenous language, arts, and culture. And in my 6 years in that position and growing up on a reservation, our language is our identity. It's the most important part of who we are. And so I'm here in support of this bill. We have a number of young people in communities, probably in every one of your districts, that are being encouraged by their elders to take an interest. And in California, we don't have a repository or an institute. In other states, we do. So to make the investment here in our state will retain our young people. So I support this.
Move the bill. Second.
Moved by Ms. Galgiani, seconded by Mr. Sajjan. Are you testifying?
No.
Okay, at this point, please. Please.
Pilar Añate Quintana, KP Public Affairs, here on behalf of the Barona Band of Mission Indians. And the reason I wanted to be sure to state the support is that Chairman Romero himself wanted to have me do so on his behalf. And he wished he was here today to do that, but here I am. So thank you.
Thanks. Appreciate that. Now, are there any other witnesses in support? Other witnesses in support? Any witnesses in opposition? Witnesses in opposition, please.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair. Wes Larson, California State University. Just to be clear here, the California State University is not in opposition to this bill and the worthiness of what of Native American linguistics as Mr. Gatto's presenting. We're concerned because, as everybody in this room knows, the tremendous cuts that certainly the CSU have received currently, and right now that's the best scenario. If June doesn't happen or later in the year with additional revenue, it's going to be even more severe to the CSU. The CSU chancellor has this authority to establish an institute center. We invite the sponsors and the author to work with the chancellor, and we'd be glad to entertain that possibility of one of our campuses hosting such a center. The problem that this legislation establishes is it creates a pressure that of a false expectation that if you put into statute then if it's not funded or not adequately funded, then the pressure is always going to be on the CSU then to fund it in light of everything else that we have to fund with our priorities and taking the cuts that we've had. So I'll give you an example of the Jazz Institute that came through this legislature several years ago with the expectation that it would get funded with non-state dollars. It's there in statute today. And so we just throw that out as our angst with this legislation. Thank you for your time.
So you're neither in support nor opposition?
Correct. Just expressing concerns.
Okay, thank you. Any other witnesses, support or opposition? Seeing none, I'll ask the committee members if there are any questions or comments. Mr. Sajjan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I value languages, and I speak few myself, and I know the difficulty that those of my side of the world that came here, that the difficulty and the cost to the private sector to have schools and teach the language. Has there been any effort to keep this language moving forward? Is it being taught in any schools or within the tribals?
Well, there's.
I mean, I just don't want to see it sit on a shelf.
Sure. There's a multitude of California native languages that are being taught in the homes. It depends on county by county. Some counties up north, the languages are spoken in as part of a high school curriculum. But what we don't have in this state is a central place where a repository can be held, where Native people and non-Native people who have an interest in helping us reestablish language can go to. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm in support of.
And I'll just address that really quickly. So of the 80 distinct languages that are represented in California, the 80 native languages, there's hundreds of dialects. But what some tribes have done, some tribes have been able to spend the resources to discuss a preservation program with the two or three elders who still speak the language. They then just bring by some basic technology, some recording devices, and then they work with an anthropologist to write a dictionary out. It's fairly basic stuff, but then that is then used to teach this. Last year, the Assembly passed a bill by Assemblymember Cotto that established a credential program for teaching of these Native American languages. And so, yeah, there is a tremendous effort to teach them in the classroom and to teach them to the young. And it's our hope that for the tribes that have not been reached yet, that have not been been able to establish their own program on their own, that this would do this. This would establish recordings of the speakers who are very elderly, basic dictionary, and then if it does want to be taught, if that language does want to be taught in future years, it would exist. As he said, there would be a repository where people could go to find how to teach these languages.
Thank you, Mr. Lara.
Mr. Gatto, I just wanted to invite you to the east part of LA, where we are doing a wonderful job of preserving our rich culture and history. I want to urge you, I'm going to support this bill. I think it's very important for obvious reasons, but I would really want you to, I urge you to work with the CSU and the Chancellor's Office in particular, because I think it is an issue that's of grave concern to mine, is the funding. And when we continue to slash from the CSU, it's going to be difficult to see where we're going to get the money to create this. But I do support the bill. I think it's very important, and I think it's a worthy cause. And hopefully maybe my alma mater can host it at San Diego State, given the rich cultural history there in San Diego. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Lara. Mr. Donnelly.
Thank you, Mr. Gatto. I support the goal of this bill. I think it's a critically important goal, especially considering our history. And I'm actually going to agree with Assemblymember Lara on something, which...
First time for everyone.
We always want to take those moments. I have a mother-in-law who speaks Ilocano, and so I understand. My wife can actually understand the language, but she can't quite speak it. So it's a critically important part of culture. But what I'm wondering is, I don't really see any outlay here on what is this going to cost us, and is there another way that this could be accomplished? Because, as I said, I think it's important, and yet, given the competition for funds, I'm afraid that it may interfere with some of our primary purposes here. So, have you guys exhausted every other possibility as far as how to get this done?
Sure. So what I'll do now is I'll address some of the cost issues, because I want to address also what was in the analysis and some of the concerns that people have brought in. I think they're very, very valid concerns, and I share them. First of all, I sit on the Appropriations Committee, and so believe me, this is going to come through again. It's going to come through a committee on which I sit, and we're going to have the opportunity to consider the costs in the appropriate committee, which happens to be Appropriations. But I also acknowledge that in this policy committee, we can talk about some of the costs as well, and that's fine. So I should stress that this program, this institute, calls for the establishment of two caseworkers, and these are caseworkers. And we could have chosen to make this a separate State Department or house it into the State Department of Indian Affairs or house it in any State Department in which we chose, right? This bill on its face, just inside the bill, just calls for the establishment of two caseworkers. Now, what I did is after we had wrote the initial bill, I amended it to house them at a university, because that makes sense to me, because universities are repositories of learning, and it makes sense to have, that's where we have the anthropologists and presumably the graduate students who would want to study these native languages. So we chose to house it at a university, but that is very different from taking funds from a university or demanding that the university system create this program. It's totally different, and I want to stress that. It's worth stressing again. This is by its nature an outreach program. These are two caseworkers, which we estimate will cost the state $150,000 to go out and collect the native languages and bring them back to a repository which people can then study. That's entirely different from creating a mandate on the university system or requiring that they establish this for time immemorial. The second point on that that's worth mentioning is that the creation of this program itself would make us eligible for federal matching funds. There are federal grants for language preservation. You have to have a program to do it. Some of the states are getting these grants. California is not. So I want to make sure that we access those grants. So you talked about exhausting different things. We've thought that through. We want to get the federal money, which is out there for these language preservation efforts. Third point is we do expect that there will be some private interest in this. We do suspect that there will be some private charity contributions to the center and some private funding. So I think with those things combined, I think this will be adequately funded without taking away from the UCs. And the last thing I'll say on that is, I wrestled with this. I mean, this is obviously a very, very tough budget year. And even $150,000 for two caseworkers, you say, gee, that's a very tough expenditure. But the problem is that the speakers of these languages are aging. And I talked to a tribe where they have one speaker left, and he's 86 years old. So we're basically facing either losing these languages forever because we wait, or taking care of it now with what I consider to be a modest expenditure. With all the other expenditures we do with the state budget, this is one that I think values and merits us to take up this year. So thank you.
Hey, Mr. Gatto, I support the concept of this bill. We've got a couple questions, though. You said a couple times providing additional money. Now, you mentioned federal matching funds, perhaps. What will be matching? Where is the funding coming from, the additional money?
Well, if the state of California funds these two positions and establishes the institute, then
fund, you mean?
Correct.
Okay.
We can then apply for federal matching funds, which I suspect we would get.
So it'd be general fund money. So it's
correct.
You also mentioned that these were caseworker positions, not faculty positions.
Correct.
Now, the last line of your bill, if you look at that line 35, says the institute shall include two faculty members. Could you clarify that?
We were talking about that as we walked in the door today, that technically, because they will be housed at a university, they're technically called faculty. But I'm not quite sure what the difference is, between faculty and caseworkers. But these are people to do outreach. And if we need to take an amendment on the bill, we will.
Okay. That's right. Great. I just wanted to clarify that, because it seemed to say they are faculty. Sure. And there are different unions involved and pay scales
involved. Of course.
Involved
Okay.
Lastly, about the institute, is this a degree? Do you envision a degree granting part of this institute, or
no? Okay. Again, this is an outreach program. This is an outreach and preservation program. This is we envision the two staff. We'll call them staff for lack of a better word. I'm not using a technical term. The two people who work here, we envision them actually going out to the tribes who are in need of the preservation. So a tribe could contact them. They could read about it. It could just be something that they know because they're graduate students who specialize in language preservation. And going to these tribes who are in need of the language preservation and interviewing the elders, talking with the people who are in many cases in their 80s or 90s, and recording their spoken language, recording the vocabulary, comparing it with other things, creating a dictionary, bringing that back to a repository, and they would work with existing degree programs for people who want to study these programs.
Well, I've got to tell you, I really do support the intent of the bill, and I will vote yes on the bill. It doesn't seem fully cooked to me yet. I will also remind my colleagues that the Appropriations Committee is the place where funding will be discussed. Right now, it's a policy matter. We're a policy committee, and I absolutely support the policy envisioned, Mr. Gatto. I think it is a very valid thing you're attempting to do. So with that, we have a motion by Ms. Galgiani, a second by Mr. Asajjan. The motion is do pass to the Appropriations Committee. Chair recommends a yes vote. Please call the roll. Were amendments accepted? I don't think so, no.
Block?
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly? Asajjan?
Aye.
Asajjan, aye. Brownlee?
Aye.
Brownlee, aye. Fong? Galgiani?
Aye.
Galgiani, aye. Lara?
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller? Portantino?
Okay, you have five votes. The bill is out. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll just say that, you know, we appreciate your comments on getting it cooked some more, and we do want it. We don't want it to be half-baked, so we'll make sure we crank the oven to 500 and get it all settled out.
Thank
all
you, right, Mr. Gatto. We count on it. As there are only committee bills left, Mr. Fong has bills, but he's not here yet. Normally, the vice chair would go first. He's been kind enough to allow the chair's bill to go first because chair has a witness who needs to leave. So in that case, we will move to item number 8, AB 620, by Assemblymember Block, and I will hand the gavel to my vice chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You may open on the bill.
Thank you. AB 620 is an anti-bullying, anti-discrimination bill. Too often we hear of harassment and bullying of lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender students that goes unreported or unaddressed at our college campuses. Too often we only hear about this after the fact, after the victim suffers mental or physical abuse, after the victim drops out because he or she doesn't feel safe attending class, after the victim turns to substance abuse or harms himself or herself. Our campuses should be places where all Californians feel secure and are able to develop their education and their talents without threat of violence. However, we know we need to pay additional attention to the plight of LGBT students in some of these cases. AB 620 helps in several ways. First of all, it will allow us to improve how we collect demographic data so we can better be aware of the presence and needs of LGBT students. Secondly, it will provide better training, strengthen hate crime awareness, and provide financial assistance and designate liaisons for LGBT issues at our campuses. Third, it will update student codes of conduct where necessary to include formal policies, rules, and regulations on harassment and bullying. Lastly, among other provisions, it will convene focus groups and assessment mechanisms to identify best practices and make additional recommendations for actions that the three higher education segments can take to improve the LGBT campus climate. There's a wide range of support for AB 620, including Equality California, the sponsor of this legislation, the Student Senate for California Community Colleges, the University of California Student Association, the Anti-Defamation League, the California Association of Marriage and Family Therapists, the California Federation of Teachers, and the National Organization for Women. With me today to speak on the bill are Matt Bunch, representing Equality California, sponsor of the bill, Eric Schachman, the chair of the California Post-Secondary Education Committee, authors of the report that provided the foundation of this bill, and others. And I will respectfully ask your aye vote today.
Move the bill. Second. Hi, my name is Matt Bunch, and I'm here on behalf of Equality California. We're pleased to sponsor the bill to promote equality and equal access in higher education.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, Vice Chairman. My name is Eric Schockman. I'm chair of the California Post-Secondary Ed Commission, CPEC, and we have actually did some research on this issue back in 2008. We began a nine-month study on issues facing lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender students in California's community colleges and universities. CPEC actually conducted research, collected data, and consulted with student campus representatives and experts in the field. And we had some very interesting results that came out of that study. It led to a report by the commission and several recommendations, which are very much commiserate with the intent of this bill. And in short, I think the recommendations are revealing about some of the data that also spills out of our research. Number one, the data indicates 4 out of 5 LGBT students feel they belong on campus, but would still choose to enroll knowing that there might be some other activities that indeed would lead them to drop out. So LBG students also reported a slightly lower levels of satisfaction belonging than non-LGBT students. 39% of LGBT students and other students were expressively negative of stereotypes viewed by their sexual orientation. Nearly 7% of LGBT students reported that faculty have expressed negative views about them on campus. Again, this is some of the, I think, the tip of the iceberg of some of the research that we were able to uncover. I'd like to just report and tell you our recommendations very quickly because, again, very commiserate with the bill. When appropriate, campuses should provide opportunities for students to identify their gender identity in all forms, and campuses should develop what the UC has developed, a survey-like student experience survey that really includes questions about gender and gender orientation. There's also the present K through 12 California State School Survey, which asks about anti-gay harassment, should also be adopted, we think, for post-secondary ed. And higher education institutions usually regularly report hate crimes and on sexual orientation and gender identity, and we also encourage further documentation. Thirdly, campuses also should create safe zones and safe havens with faculty and staff offering mentoring and counseling and dialogue with LGBT students and faculty when possible. And lastly, not all campuses in the system in higher education really do enforce nor have a non-discrimination policy and professional development for their faculty and staff dealing with direct student support for LGBT students. So in conclusion, I think the commission believes that the better the data that we have, the better the policies, the more thoughtful planning that we have, both on campuses and on a state level. The intent of this legislation really does move us one step ahead in full inclusion of a equality for all students in higher education. I thank you for your interest on this topic. I'd be happy to answer any questions from the commission that the commission has.
Mr. Chair, the bill's been moved and seconded. Would you like to proceed?
We have one more witness, if time permits.
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Lance Chi. I'm a current student at Sac State University and a transfer student from Folsom Lake College. In 2008, I actually did testify before CPEC about my experiences at Folsom Lake College and told them that the main difference between high school and college was that I was paying to be harassed. At Folsom Lake, when I tried to report a harassment by a fellow student to a faculty member, they were not aware of who I should file my report with, and to this day, I don't know if anything came about of my bringing up the incident. If faculty and staff are ill-informed on what to do once harassments have occurred on campus, can there really be a guarantee of my safety as a student and that my concerns will be addressed promptly when I make the attempt to make a complaint? As a sophomore in high school, I did actually file a complaint for being physically harassed, sexually harassed, and assaulted on campus. It took 5 years from my sophomore year to the conclusion of that incident. 3 of those years, I had graduated. Since then, various bills have been passed aimed at helping protect LGBT students at the California high school level, and I have seen changes on campus climates within area high schools. While college students may be a bit older and more mature than high school students, there are still problems of peer-to-peer harassments, and professors need to step up and help prevent them from occurring by being aware of issues that LGBT students face. Many professors have told me silence equals consent, and the silence from the current state of affairs on college campuses across the state is disheartening. I respectfully ask that you vote yes on AB 620.
And we may have other witnesses in support.
We hear the witnesses in support.
Yes, Judith Michaels, California Federation of Teachers. And I just wanted to add that although some colleges have acted swiftly on the information that the witnesses put forth, others have not. And so we are proud to support AB 620.
Ogalilia Ramirez with the California State Students Association in support of the bill.
Tiffany Mock on behalf of the ACLU, we support, and I've mentioned a technical amendment that we may suggest to the author. Thank you.
Tony Trigero on behalf of the California Teachers Association. We're processing a support position. We believe teachers are a critical component of this problem, and we look forward to passage of the bill. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Jonathan Lightman on behalf of the Faculty Association of California Community Colleges in support.
Antoinette Kamoa on behalf of the University of California Student Association in support.
Alex Bader, President, Student Senate for California Community Colleges and in support.
Joseph Vigela with the Coalition for Humane Immigrant Rights of Los Angeles. While officially we have not voiced our support for this bill, we strongly support this idea.
Are there any witnesses in opposition?
Karen Zamaripa with the California State University. I hate to be here today, but I do have to report our opposition to this bill. I think we're going to try to be as consistent as possible throughout the year, given the fiscal environment. And as we indicated in our letter, there are several new mandates on the CSU in this bill that we think are duplicative of current effort and are expensive in the context of a $500 million cut. We are requiring in this bill data collection that currently does not occur. We have 47,000 employees. We have 450,000 students. We do not currently have a regular survey that we do of our employees or our students as it relates to matters such as suggested in this bill. So we are requiring a new initiative here as it relates to specifically surveying our students and employees on this matter. Second, we are also mandating in this bill not only the development of, but the implementation of a professional development program specific to this issue. We currently have programs that, to the extent collective bargaining will allow us, that we require our employees to go through as it deals with other state laws that you've passed. We have indicated in the work that we've done with the speaker on this matter with regard to a report that we were providing to the board in May, then, in fact, we believe that we can address some of these issues as it relates to bullying, specifically, through current policy. But we believe that AB 620 goes way beyond that. There is no question there will be expenses to our institution and staffing costs at a time when I am quick to remind the legislature that what you ask us to do is protect the classroom. What that means in an environment of a $500 million cut is that we're going to have to protect the classroom, and we're going to have to look at reducing administrative costs. This is a new administrative cost that will impact the CSU as we're trying to manage these budgets. So we ask you to consider those implications. I know this is not a fiscal committee, but this is the reality that we're facing. It's not that we don't support and have ongoing efforts to deal with the safety of all students and the bullying experiences some students may occur. But at the same time, putting this kind of mandate on us at this juncture, we think is just imprudent. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition? Any questions from the panel? Mr. Lara, then.
Karen, what are the current processes right now in place for LGBT, to protect LGBT students at the CSU?
Well, we currently have anti-bullying policy. It's what exactly what we've been talking to Speaker Perez about for the last several months, who asked both our board and the UC Regents to have an item to make sure that we are clear about what our policies are. We also provide for safe environments for students, but it's not specific to those that have been identified as LGBT. We also provide, to the extent possible, with our employees within current professional development, opportunities to advise them about how to handle these things. But faculty is a very sticky wicket. That's a collective bargaining issue as it relates to and how we manage getting 47 or 26,000 of them into a training program. Those are serious implications as well as to an explicit program in this regard. We also believe that we've had policies longstanding as it relates to identification of any kind of hate crime, and I think we've demonstrated repeatedly, I believe, in responding to those quickly, aggressively, and respectfully. So I believe that there are many things in place today. There are policies in place today that we believe, in working with the speaker, we've actually addressed many of these issues. This bill goes way beyond that as it relates to the mandates that it puts in place for us that we do think will be costly.
Ms. Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to commend the author for this bill, and I'm certainly, I think as we all are, very sensitive to the fiscal issues relative to the CSU and the other segments. So I know the author will continue to work with them on this, but I think that this is a really important bill because it sets a certain bar that I think is what our expectation should be in our university settings, higher education settings, really to hear data that is indicative of faculty expressing bias towards students is just really unacceptable, and we need to create atmospheres that are healthy and bias-free. So I think the direction of this bill is really the right way to go, and I also think that all of us, or all of the segments, could potentially be very vulnerable, I think, to lawsuits and other kinds of very costly situations for them without having these kinds of policies in place. So I think we have to balance those fiscal ramifications, and I would certainly like to be added as a co-author.
Thank you, Ms. Brownlee. Ms. Galgiani.
I would like to ask the woman from CSU, what's typically the punishment for a student that is found to have been involved in a physical altercation with a student?
We have a current student discipline policy that has no tolerance as it relates to activities, and it eventually leads to suspension or expulsion. We do have to put them through a process as it relates to judicial process that we move on immediately. And again, it goes through and can lead to suspension or expulsion depending on the circumstances. And obviously, we work closely with local law enforcement agencies as it relates to any crossing the line clearly of criminal activity. That is shared with the local governments in our normal agreements with them.
Mr. Lara.
I'm also curious, Mr. Chair, in terms of if there's anybody from the UC that can speak to what the current process is.
Nadia Leal Carrillo with the University of California. We are actually in the process of still reviewing the details of the bill in itself, but we do have a commission that has been established to specifically address some of these concerns and also some of the events that have taken place in some of our UC campuses. So I can definitely follow up with more details for you, Mr. Lara, and provide you specifics as I'm not prepared at the moment to provide that. Thank you.
Okay, the bill has been Moved by Ms. Galgiani and seconded by Mr. Lara. The motion is to pass as amended to appropriations. Madam Speaker, would you...
May I close?
Oh.
No, I know we're new at this thing. No,
absolutely, Mr. Chair.
I just need to close because I need to respond to a couple of things.
Yes.
As the representative of the CSU said, of course, once someone has committed a heinous act, there is retribution for that. Part of the purpose of this bill is to stop these heinous acts from being committed on our campuses. Much more important, I've seen students after they've been bullied, after they've been badgered. Yes, the person who perpetrates, if they're caught, sometimes gets thrown out of school. Well, that's too late to have an impact on the student who's been violated. This bill is based on a recommendation from the California Post-Secondary Education Commission. We didn't pull this out of nowhere. Their job is to study what's happening in our three segments of higher education and to recommend what needs to happen. They see there is a problem here. I don't think the woman from the CSU would claim there is no problem on campuses. There is a problem. Whatever the CSU is currently doing is obviously not enough because the problem continues to exist to the extent that CPAC has done an investigation and pointed out these problems, and they have made recommendations. You know, the person from the CSU says, well, there's a cost for these programs, and that is something that an argument that should be made appropriately in the Appropriations Committee. The question before you is whether this is good policy. If you don't think it's good policy to stop bullying and to stop discrimination, if you don't think that's good policy, you should vote no on this bill. But if you think that's good policy, you should vote yes on this bill regardless of cost, because that's something that the Appropriations Committee will deal with. And let me just say, there is a cost to preventing discrimination. There is a cost to preventing bullying. The cost not preventing discrimination, not preventing bullying, is much higher. And I ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This motion has been moved by Ms. Galgiani and seconded by Mr. Lara. The motion is to pass as amended to appropriations. Madam Secretary, would you call the roll?
Block?
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly?
No.
Donnelly, no. Asajian? Brownlee?
Aye.
Brownlee, aye. Fong?
Fong, aye.
Fong, aye. Galgiani?
Aye.
Galgiani, aye. Lara?
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller? Portantino? 5-1.
That's 5-1. Measures out.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Okay, Mr. Donnelly, I apologize, but Mr. Fong has now arrived. It's up to you, because you were here before. If you can go first, or it's okay with Mr. Fong. Mr. Donnelly will then call item number one on our agenda, which is AB 63.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. AB 63 is a bill that would repeal the provisions in AB 540 that relate to those who are in the country illegally, and it would confer those benefits to those who serve in our military who are transferred into our state through no fault of their own. And that benefit would accrue to the military member themselves, to their spouses, and to their dependents. Right now, as the law stands, if you are serving in the military and you are transferred to the state of California, you are treated as an out-of-state resident. And we feel that we shouldn't be penalizing those who are willing to go fight and die for our country by making them pay a penalty, which is essentially three times the normal tuition, when, in fact, we are giving the same benefit to those who are in the country illegally. And so... I understand why we have the out-of-state provision to protect California taxpayers, to protect the investment that we've made in higher education. And I understand the provisions of AB 540 that do not affect those who are in the country illegally, but only strictly affect those who might have an administrative situation where they've moved out of the state and then come back to it with some investment in the state. So we're not touching any of those provisions. But I think it is critically important that we address and honor those who serve in our military so that they would have the same rights as those who are in the country illegally. And I think this is one of those things where the taxpayers are extremely frustrated by the cuts that we're facing right now. We've heard about cuts of $500 million to the CSU, $500 million to the UC. And so I think the taxpayer would like to see the our limited resources used for those who are willing to serve our country and not for those who happen to be in our country illegally. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Donnelly. Your witnesses have up to 6 minutes total.
Good afternoon, committee. My name is Ryan Kirkpatrick. I'm currently a college student, but I am a graduate of Cal State Fullerton, Bachelor of Science in Kinesiology from there. I'm currently attending Santa Ana College as a nursing student, and this bill, I'm in strong support of, the AB 63, because it's currently affecting some of my classmates that are going through nursing school with me. I was made aware that some of the people that I go to school with are legal immigrants from different parts of the country, one being the Philippines, and I have several other people that, but one story in particular is that one of my classmates was here for 15 years and had to pay in-state tuition until she was changing her status from conditional permanent resident status to permanent resident status. In her celebration, she went and mentioned it to the Santa Ana College faculty or admissions office, and she was actually forced to pay the penalty of her establish of residency was start over because she was considered a permanent resident. Again, I don't understand why AB 540 is causing the product of illegal immigrants being funded forced college students when in reality these students can't get a job after they have graduated college because they don't have the correct documentation to get or attain a job. So it's kind of lost funds when you're trying to provide education for students where you hit a dead end when they graduate college. The other thing too is I much rather have the person that had to struggle and pay out-of-state tuition seek the benefits because they went through the process correctly and legally, and as well as the military that have served us before we even gotten to the point of education. And I move for passing this bill.
Thank you. Next.
Good afternoon.
You took exactly 2 minutes. That's perfect.
Good afternoon. My name is Ben Strickland. I'm a student at Monterey Peninsula College, and I'm also a veteran of the United States Navy. I know from firsthand experience how difficult it is to pursue an education while on active duty from when I was taking college classes in the Navy. I see how hard some of my friends have it in Monterey, who have to pay three times more for their college classes, and we should reward their service by supporting this bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. My name is Aaron Hyde. I am the – can you hear me now?
Sure, we can hear you.
All right. I am the new student body president for Monterey Peninsula College, recently elected a few weeks ago. We're beginning a new era of student activism, you could say, as far as political things go. We recently, about a week ago, we got our student body to pass a resolution in support of this bill. And our logic behind it was we basically have two choices here. We can give this resident status to those who are here illegally, or we can give that resident status to those who have served our state. I would ask you guys to keep in mind that, I would ask you guys to keep in mind that if you vote against this bill, you're asking those who have served this state and nation sacrificing so much to continue. They will continue to pay the out-of-state tuition when they come to our state to take community college classes. I don't think we should reward illegal activity. I think we should reward something that deserves being rewarded, defending our liberties and fighting to preserve our liberties and doing what we're doing right now, participating in democracy, is because of them. I think that's what we should reward. I think we have to know where our priorities are. And, you know, as far as politics go, I would like you guys to keep in mind that only one of these two groups will be able to vote in your next election on the basis of your decision today. And I conclude with that. Thank you.
Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Witness in opposition, please just state your name and the organization you represent and what your opposition. Actually, you get up to 6 minutes. Yeah, you get up to 6 minutes, but 6 minutes divided by all of you is going to be very brief.
We have students.
You do have a couple who are, okay. Will those witnesses who are here to give testimony beyond just stating name, please come up here and fill these chairs? And you will have up to 6 minutes between the three of you. And I'll ask, yes. Okay, you may begin. These are witnesses in opposition.
Good afternoon, Chair and committee members. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. My name is Anna. I am attending De Anza Community College and will be transferring to San Jose State University in the fall, majoring in political science and environmental justice. I am an NEB 540 student. When I was in high school, my counselor told me that I was ineligible to go to college, despite the fact that I was an honor student for all 4 years. I was active in cross country, track, and soccer. I have lived in California since I was 7 years old, and to this day consider it my only home. Currently, I am an active member both in my community and my school. I'm a steering committee member of the California Dream Network, which was founded in 2003 as a project of CHIRLA. It is a statewide network consisting of emerging college campus organizations who actively address undocumented student issues and work to create broader social change around immigration reform. I'm also the co-founder of a student organization at my college named Integral Movement for AB 540 Student Success. I'm also the chair of environmental sustainability in my student government. AB 540 matters to me because it gave me the opportunity to give back to my community. I would not have been able to pay in-state tuition. I would not have been able to afford it at all if AB 540 did not exist. Without AB 540, I would have never, it would have, basically when I was in high school and I heard that I couldn't go to college, I was pretty much crushed. I was in limbo my whole life. You know, what does undocumented mean? Up until I found out what it actually meant, actual education, like funds for education. Repealing AB 540 does actually more harm than good because, having said all of that, 70% of AB 540 students are actually legal residents or citizens. The other 30% are undocumented students or undocumented people and would not be able to afford college if AB 540 is repealed. This law has been critical to the lives of many young individuals like myself because it has given me hope and an opportunity to pursue my dream of higher education. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Orly, and I am also currently at a community college at De Anza with plans to transfer to a four-year university to major in nursing. I am an AB 540 student as well. When I was in high school, I was talking with some friends about going to college, and one of them told me we weren't allowed to go because all of us didn't have a social. So prior to that, my plans were to go to college and become a nurse. I became discouraged and made plans to graduate high school and find a job. My dreams of going to college pretty much disappeared overnight. I felt that my dreams were at the tip of my hands, but upon finding this out, my dreams felt as if they slipped away from my hands. Once I told my parents and teachers that I was not going to college, my parents and teachers said not to give up and to continue to pursue my dreams. I met a community liaison who helped me apply to the community college and obtain AB 540 status. I was finally able to enroll in college and pursue my dreams. So my first year in college, I was a member of IMAS, Integral Movement for AB 540 Student Success, and I was also involved in First Year Experience, which is a program to facilitate a student's first year at college. This program helped keep me motivated and understand what was needed
what was needed for me to succeed in college and individually. In my second year, I became an officer of IMS. AB 540 allows me to attend college, pursue my dreams, and realize the goal of becoming a nurse someday. Nursing to me is a way to give back directly to my community and one day work with children. I hope to one day work in the maternity ward working with infants and help new moms learn about their new babies. Repealing AB 540 would crush so many undocumented dreams. For example, my dreams. I would completely lose hope and I would question what my future holds. Thank you.
Thank you. You have 1 minute and 45 seconds left. Last witness.
Oh, okay. Well, I just want to mention, my name is Elizabeth. I'm with Stand at Sac State, that California will need 1 million graduates by 2020, and repealing AB 540 will greatly affect those numbers. And on a personal note, my friend's undocumented. She's married to a U.S. Marine. He has been unable to help her attain residency. So I just want to say that the immigration system is more complicated and complex than people think. My other friend, who's actually AB 540 and is about to graduate from law school from UC Davis, her boyfriend is also in law school, and he's an Iraqi veteran and former Air Force service member. And he was granted in-state tuition in California. I mean, he is from California, but, you know, he traveled all over the country serving in the Air Force, and he was able to receive in-state tuition with no problem. So I don't get what the issue is with U.S. service members not being able to get in-state tuition.
Okay, thank you. Thanks to all the witnesses on both sides. Now we'll hear from other witnesses in opposition. Just state your name, organization, and that you oppose the bill.
Jeanette Sanipatin, legislative staff attorney with the Mexican Legal Defense and Educational Fund. Just one short comment. The military provisions are unnecessary in this bill because our state already conforms to federal law.
That, but
thank you.
Antonia Kamal with the University of California Student Association, opposed unless amended.
Alex Pater, Student Senate President. We support veterans. However, with AB 540, we cannot support it. Opposed unless amended. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ogunilia Ramirez with the California State Student Association. We oppose the repeal of AB 540, so we have opposed unless amended also.
Erica Romero with the Hispanic Association of Colleges and Universities, also opposed unless amended.
Joseph Vigela with the Coalition for Humane Immigrant Rights of Los Angeles, also opposed unless amended.
Tony Trigero, California Teachers Association, Community College Association, opposed unless amended.
Judith Michaels, California Federation of Teachers, we are opposed.
Jonathan Lightman, Faculty Association, California Community Colleges, opposed unless amended. And although they don't have a formal position on the bill, the EOPS Association takes a very strong support for AB 540 students. Thank you.
Andrew Martinez, California State University, opposed unless amended.
Kevin Wolfork, California Post-Secondary Education Commission, opposed unless amended.
Tina Everhart, National Association of Social Workers, and we oppose unless amended. Thank you.
Nadia Leal Carrillo with the University of California in opposition.
Shayla Ramos with Integral Movement for AB 540 Student Success at De Anza College, and we are in opposition.
Mr. Chairman and Committee, Bonnie Slauson representing the Community College League, and our position is opposed unless amended.
Daniel Galan of De Anza Community College in opposition.
Samantha Vasquez, Student Ambassador at Evergreen Valley College, and Cochitlo Valley President in opposition.
Ignacio Hernandez, behalf of the California Immigrant Policy Center, in opposition.
Tiffany Mock, on behalf of the American Civil Liberties Union, in opposition.
Good afternoon, Lisa Douglas, representing AICCU member schools, and we're opposed unless amended. Thank you.
Chris Savoli, representing the College Board, in opposition.
Thank you. Any more witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, I think I have a couple of committee members that wish to ask questions or comment, then we'll go to your close. Ms. Galgiani.
Yes, I think it's clear that each of the members would want to see the provisions for you moving forward. However, there are many concerns about the provisions with AB 540. I'm wondering if, with the will of the committee, perhaps we can take an amendment to strike the AB 540 provision from the bill and move the bill forward without 540 in it.
Would the author accept that friendly amendment?
No, I feel that the two are intrinsically linked, that the costs of the AB 540 provision is creating an incentive for more illegal immigration. And so while given the budget situation we're in, we're trying to make a bill that's net neutral or net positive.
And I know, Ms. Galjani, a lot of folks who were opposed unless amended share your concern because they do support the veterans portion of this bill, the support for our veterans, but oppose the AB 540 portion. So let me just say, earlier in the agenda today, when we adopted our consent agenda, that included AB 853 by Assemblyman Blumenfield, which basically did exactly what this bill does in terms of granting veterans the rights and opportunities that this bill would grant. So that portion has already been adopted by this committee. So all that's really in this bill right now that is of impact is the anti-AB 540 portion. Mr. Lara.
Mr. Donnelly, you know, with all due respect, I know there's a lot of talk about what taxpayers want and what they're perceived to want in our state. But let me tell you about the taxpayers in my district. My taxpayers in my district want immigration reform. The taxpayers in my district want to ensure that every child, regardless of immigration status, have an opportunity to pursue a college education. And, you know, my taxpayers want their children to, you know, be productive members of our society and contribute at a greater level to our economy. And so, you know, I want you to know that, you know, I know the Mr. President here talked about the repercussions for us that, you know, not support this bill. But let me tell you that my constituents in my district, you know, want AB 540. And it is an important vehicle for them. And to say that these students are funded is a complete fallacy because these students don't receive any funding. These students raise their own money and pay for their own tuition just like anybody else. And so I just wanted to make that a point and be a voice for my constituents in Southeast LA County in the 50th District.
Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, Mr. Donnelly, you may close.
Sure. I want to address Mr. Lara's point. I appreciate you standing up for your constituents, and I know that you understand that I need to stand up for mine. And this bill, if it were passed, would not stop or preclude anyone who has an undocumented status from attending college. What this bill would do is it would remove the in-state tuition exemption, which essentially is a discount that we give to people who are in-state. I came here from out-of-state. So I paid three times the tuition for 1 year until I established legal residency. That serves as a protection for the taxpayers of California. And it also serves as a protection for the legal citizens who want to compete for those spots in college. And it serves as a protection for those who are coming to the country legally and lawfully. And I notice that you like to blur the line between legal and illegal immigration. And I think that there needs to be a clear distinction. I don't want to penalize anyone. If people who are undocumented or illegally here want to go to college, they're able to do that in the state of California. But I think that there should be, they would have to pay the out-of-state tuition just like I did when I came here. And the point of the bill is to protect that. It's also to honor our veterans. And in terms of what the chair said, it just came to my attention that there is a bill that's doing this, and I will support that bill. And I think all of us here do support that. But I think that what we are doing is we are inculcating into law and codifying into law with AB 540 an incentive for people to come into the country illegally, more people, not just the people who happen to be here and who were brought here through no fault of their own. And I think that that's a very dangerous precedent to set, and I think that that is why I brought this bill forth. I believe that another thing, we always hear people talk about this being an investment, but if you're not legally able to work here after you go to college, then we've got another problem. So what you're really saying is, and I've heard this from many people, including Assemblymember Cedillo, who came here, is that this whole idea of AB 540 being an investment rests on a larger scheme of amnesty. You call it comprehensive immigration reform. I call it amnesty, where if we get amnesty, then everybody has the right to work, then everybody has papers, then everything's great. But right now we have a legal and an illegal immigration system, and illegal immigration is costing us billions and billions of dollars. And given the budget deficit we have, I think that we need to say, what are our priorities? And that's what the purpose of this bill is. I ask for your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Donnelly. Mr. Lara.
Sean, I just have another question. I know we've had AB 540, and I know exactly what the bill does. And I know we've had it in place since October 21, 1991. How many, do we have any studies or any numbers of how many illegal immigrants have come in to take advantage of AB 540 since we've had it in place?
First of all, there's very, very few reliable numbers on the number of people who are in college right now. I noticed a number of the students here referenced themselves as AB 540 students. They didn't say whether they were documented, undocumented. They just said AB 540. My understanding is, and I've heard numbers thrown around, that 70% of the students who are on AB 540 have legal, lawful immigration status, that they've moved out of the state of California after serving 3 years in high school and then come back for whatever reasons. We have no objections to that, and we aren't repealing that component of AB 540. We're only repealing the component that would deal with those who are in the country unlawfully. And unfortunately, if you look at the census numbers, which just came in, it lends you to believe that the government is not keeping very good track of those who are in the country illegally. So the truthful answer to your question is we don't know. But if you were in another country that was a war-torn country where you couldn't provide food and shelter for your family, and there's a country that's giving you not just K-12 education for your children, but also a college education paid for by the taxpayers of that state, you'd be a fool not to come here. And I empathize with the fathers who want to come here and provide a better life for their children. But we have to have a discussion about what are we going to do with the resources we have here in California. So that's why I've put forth this bill. I respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Mr. Donnelly. Yes, Mr. Miller.
Thank you. I'd like to move the bill.
Okay, there's a motion. Is there a second? There is a motion. Is there a second?
Can Mr. Donnelly second? I second it.
Yes, that's appropriate. Okay, it has been...
First one I've ever done.
It has been moved and seconded. Moved by Mr. Miller, seconded by Mr. Donnelly. The chair recommends a no vote on this. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Block?
No.
Block, no. Donnelly?
Yes.
Donnelly, aye. Asajian? Brownlee?
No.
Brownlee, no. Fong?
No.
Fong, no. Galgiani? Lara?
Lara, no.
Lara, no. Miller?
Aye.
Miller, aye. Portantino?
2-4. Your bill has two aye votes to be placed on call. Thank you, Mr. Donnelly.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members.
We move to our last author of the day. That is Mr. Fong. Mr. Fong, I believe you have two bills, items 12 and 15. The first is AB 852.
Okay, Mr. Chair and members, first of all, I'd like to accept the committee's suggested technical amendment noted on the last page of the analysis. AB 852 provides job security to part-time faculty in California's community colleges and ensures continuity and stability in our classrooms, which translates into greater student success. Specifically, AB 852 requires community college districts to place the names of their part-time faculty on a reemployment preference list. An employee on this list will be provided with the rights of first refusal to a teaching assignment in his or her department. AB 852 is needed because there has been a growing trend in California that full-time tenured faculty at community colleges are diminishing and being replaced by underpaid part-time faculty. California's 43,000 community college part-time faculty members, representing nearly two-thirds of all community college faculty, teaching 40% of the California community college classes. Though it may be economically attractive, this reliance on part-time faculty to teach a large proportion of the classes has resulted in generally unacceptable working conditions for part-time faculty, particularly for those who are committed to and depend on teaching as their primary source of income. In addition, this reliance on part-time faculty is negatively impacting our students as well. Students who do not have instructional consistency do not receive the same benefits as others. For example, continuity of instruction, mentoring, curriculum development, and learning outcomes assessments are all services that part-time faculty struggle to provide for their students. AB 852 will ensure job stability for part-time faculty members and increase the educational integrity and professionalism of our community colleges. I respectfully request your aye vote. I have some witnesses.
Thank you, Ms. Fong. Witnesses in support, up to 6 minutes total.
Thank you, Chairman Block and Assembly members. My name is Deborah Shanks. I am a part-time faculty member in the Contra Costa Community College District, where I have been teaching for over 28 years as a part-time faculty member. I also serve on the Faculty Association of California Community Colleges Board of Governors as their part-time faculty officer. Also in my district, I serve as the part-time faculty advocate, so I do a variety of things for part-timers. This bill is extremely important because it would afford part-time faculty who do make up the bulk of faculty in the community college system some minimal sense of job security while allowing for flexibility to local districts through collective bargaining. Many of these faculty teach transfer courses, basic skills courses, and career technical courses. It's an important state policy for workforce stability. And due to the workforce reductions, as we know, you've heard from CSU and UCs, et cetera, that is, it is even more important at this time to ensure program stability. It also promotes student success, and I know that's also very important to the various members. Students come to rely on stability of faculty within a department. They rely on the student network to tell each other who are the best faculty to take for any given subject. They look to respected faculty members to be there for advice, to return to them for additional courses, and to rely on their expertise in their field. A stable, reliable workforce.
Moved by Mr. Lara, seconded by Ms. Galgiani.
Keep going. A stable, reliable workforce improves student success. It lends credibility and stability to a program, and it allows departments to build a better comprehensive and coordinated offering of programs and courses. And in many ways, this bill would ensure a more stable community college system by building and supporting a community of faculty who work together, know their students, and understand the institutional environment of their college. So this is good state policy that would allow for transparent staffing based upon a process which is both logical and predictable instead of arbitrary. So I urge you to pass this bill along because it will be good for students as well as faculty and the stability of our system in a very, very trying time.
Thank you. 90 seconds left for remaining witnesses.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I passed out this document, which I think will be helpful in terms of identifying repetition on the district. We believe that retaining qualified My name's Tony Trigero with the California Teachers Association, Community College Association. We believe that retaining qualified part-time faculty would assist students in completing their coursework because faculty could and would remain on the campus and in the profession, their chosen profession. It also speaks to creating jobs by assuring that qualified part-time faculty will not have to worry semester to semester about where they will be working and still allows for flexibility for administrators. And we disagree slightly in the analysis that there are many of the 72 districts which actually have this language in their collective bargaining agreements. They don't. Administrators mostly refuse to bargain. I think the analysis points out clearly the difficulty with the language that we currently have. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Judith Michaels, California Federation of Teachers, in support. And I think that most of the points have been made, but certainly that students win too by having a more stable workforce, even though these part-time faculty are classified in the Ed Code as temporary. In fact, as supported by the witnesses, they're far from transient. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional witness?
No. Next bill.
Oh, okay. Are there any other witnesses in support? Please come forward, state your name and organization you represent. Any witnesses in opposition, please come forward. You may have up to 6 minutes to testify.
Mr. Chairman and committee, Bonnie Slauson representing the Community College League, and hopefully I won't take the 6 minutes. Although this bill does echo some of the best practices of our districts, mandating one system at a time when we are being very challenged to be able to even maintain courses for our students. You've heard about the cost pressures that the segments of higher education are going through right now, $500 million for CSU and UC respectively, $400 million for community colleges, and possibly up to $1 billion if the tax measures do not go on the ballot. This is not the time to be mandating a one particular process. We feel that there are costs for the bill for realignment of existing collective bargaining agreements. I did do some research last year going through, I don't know how many collective bargaining agreements myself. There were a variety of them that did provide some form of reinstatement rights or first right of refusal, but they were written in different manners and different processes. And there was some challenges, especially for those that had multiple colleges in their districts. I think your most recent amendments did address that, making it based on college rather than district. However, we do find that there will be many challenges for our colleges to try and do the realignment. The legislation is laudable. We do agree that a steady and consistent workforce is a plus for our system and for student success. However, mandating one process and one criterion at this time when we're facing such multiple challenges on our colleges and students, we believe is not the right thing at this time. And there are collective bargaining agreements out there that do have some form of right of return and right of first refusal, but just differently written and different means of going about the same thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, any questions, comments from committee members? Seeing none, Mr. Fong, you may close.
I urge your aye vote.
Thank you, Mr. Fong. This bill may have cost pressures, and this is a probably not the best time to limit flexibility of colleges with declining budgets. However, I think as a policy committee, I think it's absolutely the right policy to have experienced faculty have first shot at full-time positions. We need more full-time faculty. So despite my misgivings what you may encounter in appropriations, I will vote yes and support this and recommend a yes vote. It's been moved by Mr. Lara, seconded by Ms. Galgiani. Chair recommends due pass to Assembly Appropriations Committee. Please call the roll.
Block.
Aye.
Block, aye. Donnelly. Asajian. Brownlee.
Aye.
Brownlee, aye. Fong.
Aye.
Fong, aye. Galgiani.
Aye.
Galgiani, aye. Lara.
Aye.
Lara, aye. Miller. Miller, no. Portantino. Portantino, aye.
6-1, your bill is out. Thank you, Mr. Fong.
Thank
Next
you.
Author is Mr. Fong.
Thank you.
Mr. Fong, we're now moving to agenda item 15, which is your AB 970.
Expansion of Cal Grant B program. Mr. Chair and members, AB 970 expands access to higher education and allows low-income students to attend college of their choice. Specifically, AB 970 gives Cal Grant B recipients financial assistance to pay for tuition and fees for all 4 years of college. AB 970 is needed because currently 98% of Cal Grant B recipients are not able to use their award money to pay for tuition during their first year of college, which is typically the largest hurdle in attending college for many students. When the Cal Grant B program was created, legislators at the time were under the mistaken belief that low-income students could not or should not directly enroll in a four-year college or university. California has made great strides in all areas of civil justice since the 1960s, and this notion is no longer widely held.
Moved by Mr. Lara, seconded by Mr. Portantino.
However, without alterations to the Cal Grant B program, many deserving students will not be able to attend college of their choice. In a period of economic downturn, expanding opportunities to attend college is even more important. To rebuild our economy, to grow, to compete nationally and globally, California needs a highly skilled workforce that can drive economic recovery and increase productivity. AB 970 eliminates the current restrictions on Cal Grant B awards and allows first-year students increased opportunity to obtain a post-secondary education. I respectfully request your aye vote.
Thank you, Mr. Fong. Witnesses in support.
Good afternoon. My name is Laura Zabo-Kubitz, and I'm a policy associate at the Institute for College Access and Success. We're an independent, nonpartisan research and policy organization based in Oakland, California. As advocates for more accessible and affordable higher education for students from all backgrounds, we at the Institute strongly support AB 970, which would provide first-year tuition and fee benefits to Cal Grant B recipients. Through Cal Grant A, the state already provides 4 years of tuition and fee support for middle-income students, but students with lower incomes who receive Cal Grant B do not receive tuition and fee support until their second year of college. Cal Grant B was designed under the assumption that low-income students would attend community colleges where tuition and fee costs are covered by the Board of Governors fee waiver. However, Cal Grant B's structure has the unintended consequence of steering qualified students away from attending four-year colleges. Not every graduating high school student can enroll straight into the University of California or the California State University, but those who can do so should do so. And that's because college students are best served by going to the best college they can. And choosing less selective or rigorous colleges than necessary can actually hold students back from earning a degree.